Good evening. It is a pleasure to be with you for the third Queens Public Library's weekly read aloud of the winning entries for our Tell Your Tale program. My name is Dennis Walcott, and I am the president and CEO of the Queens Public Library System. I hope you are having a great summer and are continuing to learn even though school is out. Learning is one of the great pleasures in life, and the Queens Public Library is committed to providing many opportunities for children and adults alike to keep learning and help them go farther in their lives. One of the great learning opportunities the library offers is a robust summer reading program for school-age children. This program came to life through a generous grant from the New York Life Foundation, and I want to extend my sincere gratitude to them for their ongoing support. Tell Your Tale is part of this summer's reading program. Through it, we offer many, many more reading and writing activities and exercises during the summer. To find out about them, visit summerreading.queenslibrary.org. That's summerreading.queenslibrary.org. Parents who are watching, when you visit the site, be sure to sign up your child for the summer reading program on Read Squared. That's Read Squared. And please visit queenslibrary.org to sign up for an e-library card and find out about QPL or Queens Public Library's many other virtual programs, or access an ebook, e-magazine, an audiobook, and other resources as well. You could also make a donation to our foundation for just a generous support to the Queens Public Library. But most importantly, for you, no matter where you are, make sure you also take the 10 to 15 minutes that are required to fill out the 2020 census right from our website, or you can visit my2020census.gov to fill it out. So much is riding on an accurate account, including billions of dollars for our schools, our roads, healthcare, and the number of seats for children who are represented in the House and dealing with all the issues of our country. To date, in New York City, only 50% have signed up or responded so far. Every New York City resident counts, no matter your immigration status or where you live. Please fill it out today. Now it is my honor to talk about those who have contributed to make this program great. And we are so pleased because as a result of two great entries, we have the opportunity to share their story with you. Now, I want to be perfectly honest and tell you that some of the words coming up, I may mispronounce because these middle school students are way beyond me at this particular point in time. Our first entry that I'll read is a person, while we had a limit of 450 words for the essays, this first individual filled out the form and wrote 3,500 words. Let me repeat that. 450 was the limit, and his essay was 3,500 words. Obviously, I will not read all 3,500 words to you today, but I just want to compliment him and all the people who really contributed to make this exercise so great. The name of the tale is Kumalexi, written by John Zuna, who is a rising seventh grader at PSIS 78, also known as the Holliswood School. John, please forgive my pronunciation of some of the names in your brilliant stories about good and evil, but I will give it a good try. So again, John, thank you very much for your entry. The story is Blue Blade snapped his finger and blue smoke appeared, and suddenly they were in a magic place inside the grandmother's house. The floor looked different colors of lava, but they didn't sink or get burned. The forest was magical. The leaves shone like stars. They could hear the flowers like birds. The sky was pink with three moons. On the way to see the great master, they could see the magical creatures. Some looked like snakes with four legs. Others were furry, round creatures. Also, some creatures looked like dinosaurs, both big and small. Some had two long necks. Others had feathers with fur. Some had colorful, bright scales. And Richard's jaw dropped to the ground, and still frozen, Thomas gasped with excitement and raised his eyebrows to the sky. Wow, this is beautiful, thought Richard. And in this new place, the brothers meet the Grand Master's Bonum. And the Grand Master was great. And Bonum shows them a big book. This old book of wisdom, it was written many years ago and is a collection of many legends. And there is a legend that said, when evil rises, two redhead brave boys with kind and good hearts will save our world with their wisdom, said Bono. When Richard saw the pictures in the book, his face was tight and butterflies knotted in his stomach. Thomas froze and his forehead wrinkled as he stared. Wait a minute, those boys from the book look just like us, shouted Richard. Oh boy, this is heavy, thought Thomas. How is that possible? How did you find us? Shouted Richard. Bonum, with a calm voice, started explaining to the boys about the legend in the book. Many years ago, as a group of great masters wrote their vision in this book, they studied the stars so they could be able to understand the stars. And the old masters know how to communicate with the stars. And for hundreds of years, all the masters studied their vision, the legends in the book. When Haldimand became evil, we learned that the legend was true and we have to do something to stop him, explained Bodum. And with that, the boys were gasping and their bodies were shaking. Couldn't believe what they were hearing. They froze and stared at Bonum. Do you see my blue ring? The color of the stone is very important. When the masters that wear a ring keep a good heart, the stone on the ring is blue. But if the masters become evil, the color in the stone turns to red. The more evil things the master does, the redder the stone will be. Only a great master with a good heart can have a blue ring like this. The ring has several powers, and one of them is to find the location of people who have good in their hearts. And when you went to that basement, my ring shone more than ever. So I sent Bubli to find you, explained Bono. Oh, boy, that is really great, thought Thomas. And then Thomas said, we need you. We waited a very long time for you. Haldimand, in a very powerful and now will not stop killing, he wants more power, said Bono. And that is the end of the tale. So I think we deserve to give him a very big hand for a creative book that obviously is really short right now, but it's 3,500 words. And my compliments to you for outstanding work. Now, the next title is Daniel's Time Machine. And with Daniel's Time Machine, it is a fascinating story. And Daniel is really somebody who's extremely important. As Daniel was eating lunch, his dog started barking. It seemed urgent. Daniel got up, opened the screen door that led to his backyard. Sparky bolted outside, but when he finished eating, he saw that Sparky didn't leave a mess at all. This time he was able to make sure he was louder than ever before. He seemed to have been sniffing something on the ground. When Daniel gave it a closer look, he realized it was something metallic. The part that was visible from the surface had some ancient runes engraved into it. "This is a relic." Daniel immediately called a crew of archaeologists to investigate further. To think that the week after Daniel moved into his new home would be so exciting was such a find. Days passed, and slowly but surely, the archaeologists uncovered a time machine. One day, when Daniel went outside to see how the digging team was doing, he noticed that they had already finished. They had just gone and left behind the machine on the lawn. Of course, Daniel was tempted. He went inside the metal box. It had many hinges and levers and buttons, which Daniel never dared to press or pull. He read the words marked under each button and dial. They all said things like future, past, or years. There were many other things to press as well, but they were too small for Dan to care to read. He just really wanted to try the machine. With caution, Dan slowly brought his finger to the past button. He always wanted to see ancient Greece, or so he pressed the button past. Ancient Greece was like 80 million years ago, right? Dan thought to himself. Dan thought that all was going to be right there for him. Assured that it was, he turned back the years knob until it reached 80 million years ago. He suddenly felt something grumbling and rumbling all around him. Then many lights flashed. Then the machine stopped and flung him into the air. A mile away, in the blink of an eye, Daniel was 80 million years ago. However, he was nowhere near his time machine. "Wait," Daniel said aloud. "This isn't ancient Greece." He looked around and he saw a group of stegosauruses grazing on grasses. "I'm in the dino era," Daniel yelled. Suddenly, Daniel saw his worst fears come to life. A giant T-Rex was rampaging, galloping towards him. Dan stopped and to think he had a plan. He ran straight to the T-Rex, ran straight under its legs. The T-Rex was behind him and looking around. And after a few minutes, Daniel made it back to the time machine. Once he was home, he promised to himself that he would never, ever use something without permission, and that he would never tell anyone about what was buried in his backyard. And the author's name of this story is Matthew Suarez, and Matthew attends IS 119. So I want to take this opportunity to thank both of our authors for outstanding work, and make sure you please, all of you, pay attention to what's happening on our Queens Library website, because we have so many virtual programs going for our youth, and soon to start our summer after school activities called our Stacks program as well. And you will also see that on our site. So thank you for joining me. It is truly an honor to read these stories, but more importantly, it is great to be a part of a great reading audience here at Queens Public Library. And thank you very much.